something funny at a wedding or something. One incident, there was his bride. She was so heavy. Oh, my God. My father said, I'm going to make a maquette of that. And that was one of his most popular maquette where he dresses up as a bride. He looked like a real woman. He was fantastic.
His repertory of 500 impersonations earns their creator the title King of Impersonators. His audiences see themselves with sympathy and humor, undergoing a rigorous and incomplete process of assimilation.
His last performance was in February of 1946. And we did the performance, and I told him, I said, Pop, why don't you retire, Pop? He said, I can't retire. He said, if you make me retire, I'll die. But we convinced him to retire. It didn't even last a month.
It's too bad there's no one that took over the things that he used to do.
He is fondly remembered as the smiling man in the funny costumes, big noses, and crazy wigs who makes his compatriots, strangers in a strange land, feel at home. The advent of Marconi's radio lends a new dimension to the Italian-American theater.
And there, the radio would be... And there, the radio would be on from morning till night, and it only was the Italian programs. So naturally, I became very familiar with all the Italian singers and the comedians and the drama. But among the ones I remember best of all, of course, was my Aunt Emma Alba Gloria with Angelo Gloria, Attilio Barbato, and Alga Barbato.
Over here, there was a time, well, during the Depression, there was no work at all whatsoever, either in the theater or anything. So that was very slow. Then the radio came up, and that's how everybody started working, through the radio. They formed companies, different companies on the radio. Donna Vicenza and Company was considered number one comedy program on the air. We had so many programs. We worked with WOV, WHOM, WVD. Whatever we did on the radio, it was brought on the stage. Whatever program was on the air, it was turned into a play and we showed it on the theater. And that's how we all worked. We toured all around New Jersey, Connecticut, and Pennsylvania. They all wanted to see it on the stage. They wanted to see the people. They wanted to know who was who and who was what.
My aunt, Donna Vicenza, and her husband, they were known as the Sicilian Theatrical Company. They concentrated on these Sicilian comedies, and they were great.
Donna Vicenza and Company, yes. Mm-hmm. That was the radio name which was brought to the stage after the program.
And what was Donna Vicenza?
Oh, she was full of life, loving and sweet and adorable. That's all I can say. Mm-hmm. Well, my mother, she was unique. She was really great. She worked better as a comedian rather than a dramatic, although she was just as good as a dramatic, but she inclined to be more as a comedian. And she was tops.
And her most famous
role?
She
was really tops. When we had the program, that she gave us the airs and she would speak French with an Italian accent, so you can imagine what it would sound like. Angelo Gloria also, he was also a good writer, a good director, a good actor. He also wrote the scripts for the radio. Most of them were written by him and directed by him. No matter what he did, he was a perfectionist. It had to be just tops. He was just simply marvelous.
After Angelo Gloria's death, Attilio Barbato manages the company with his sister Olga.
My first experience is really in Italy, because I was born from actors. My mother, my brother, and my father were actors, and we were working in Italy. I grew up on the stage. In fact, I was probably born on the stage. I began working when I was 4 years old. And so to me, the stage is like being at home.
zitte e lasciatemi parlare.
Casomai, parla catone.
Ho detto di starte zitta.
Perché? Tu solo hai diritto a parlare.
Sicuro, io solo.
Please, mamma, let him talk.
The Italian theater is different than the American. The American, each one does separate things. In the Italian theater, you either do them all or nothing.
Doing it all in the Italian theater, Vincent Gardenia emerges as a star.
Your mother and I were married 52 years. Nobody died. You were married, what, 2 years? Somebody's dead. Don't get married again, Loretta. It don't work out for you.
Here he reminisces about his early days with his father's company.
The Gennaro Gardenia Dramatic Company, we used to call it. Mm-hmm. And we kept, made a living in this world, in this America at that time, and now with the Italian theater, which is a small community theater. And I thought that, and I still look back and I'm amazed that he was able to achieve that. It was quite an experience, and he was a wonderful, wonderful actor. He was a very dramatic ballad and romantic star. He sang, he acted very well, a very handsome man. He played mostly musical plays. He had a marvelous voice and a marvelous presence. And they had melodramas in those days. It always reflected the families in Italy, the nostalgia, the leaving the country, the families being apart. The plays were always about family, about relationships. And they were wonderful plays. They were very, very melodramatic, you know. But they were very nostalgic and wonderful. And it kept the Italian community together.
His father was an excellent dramatic actor, really. He was. He did all the heavy dramas, you know. And like I said, you know, he's big, big man, a nice voice. He had a beautiful voice. He sang the, they would sing the love songs to the heroine, and really his voice really got right through you.
First of all, he was a very tremendous singer. He had a powerful, powerful voice. The Brooklyn Academy of Music was like home to my grandfather. It was packed every time they did a show. With the dramatic scenes, it was there was a lot of handkerchiefs in the audience. People were very emotional, crying. But everybody at the end walked out and had an excellent evening. It was really a good show and a lot of fun.
First, he was a beautiful, good-looking man. The second, he had a heart, big heart. And when we used to rehearse over here, because I have a lot of memory over here, in this room. When he used to rehearse, we used to cry, because he used to cry all the time. Very dramatic, you know. It's, that's what it was, because the people that used to cry just for see Mr. Gardenia on the stage.
Gardenia would do the heavy drama, and he was huge, and usually was sometimes comical that his leading lady weighed about 100 pounds, and he was about 200. So whenever he embraced her for a kiss, she disappeared. You couldn't stand, couldn't see her anymore.
And at the age of 5, he put me on stage. They needed a little shoeshine boy, and I was always with him, so I went on. And I'm still on stage since I was 5 years old, but he taught me almost everything that I do today. I learned from the Italian theater, because I never stopped working from the age of 5, 6, 7, 10. In fact, at the age of 11, 12, I was playing juvenile roles. At the age of 18 or 19, I was a character actor. At 23, 24, I was playing my father's father with beards and mustaches. I never played them well at that time, but it was a fantastic experience, you know. You learn by doing. I didn't go to school, acting school, just by doing it. In fact, when I was about 19 or 20, I started doing comedy. A lot of things that I copied from other people, from the American comics, I would translate them to the Italian, you know. He was always the star. He was the main attraction. They loved him. But as I got older, I started to produce the shows for him. I started to book the shows for him. I would sort of semi-direct the shows, you know, sort of. But he was in charge of everything. But he was the main attraction. I was sort of the producer, and acted, and put up scenery, and drove the car, and drove the truck, and cleaned the theater.
They were doing a very dramatic scene, and my uncle is supposed to stab himself in the play. And they couldn't find the knife, the prop. So he runs backstage, he says, "Where's the knife? Where's the knife?" And one of the people backstage didn't know what he needed it for, and they gave him a real knife. And he goes on stage, and he actually stabbed himself on stage. And they had to close the curtain, and the emergency medical services came in. And I remember my grandfather after saying, "This is life."
Why do you think it all died?
Italian immigration stopped. They weren't, and the immigrants were getting old. That's what happened.
It started in the 50s. The new ones that came in, they didn't want to go to Italian theater. They wanted to go to discos. They wanted to learn American, you know? And they wanted the car. They wanted television.
The curtain is down, and the theater is finished.
The old-time theater is a memory, but a new generation now writes in English about the contemporary Italian-American experience. Joanne Tedesco, Leonard Melfi, and Mario Fratti. Donna Di Matteo, Richard Vitere, Julie Bavasso, Albert Inarrato. A modern Italian-American theater has already emerged. Look for it. I'm Emilisa Aleandri. Curtain.
Paisano. Lei sa che quel che dico è verità. Se per le vie del mondo vede un tipo che italiano vada a stringergli la mano, o chissà in cuore che cosa, e gli dico, uè, paesano, uè, 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 paesano, uè, paesano, come sta, uè, paesano, come sta.
How glad the many millions of Annabelles and Lillians would be to capture me. But you had such persistence, you wore down my resistance. I fell, and it was swell. I'm your big and brave and handsome Romeo. How I won you, I shall never, never.